Welcome to San Carlos Community Church. We are an international church located in San Carlos, Sonora, Mexico. And we welcome those who are joining us from Facebook. We want to say that we have translator devices. And, this is next. Si tú necesitas traducción, tenemos aparatos de traducción ahí atrás, puedes tomarlos. We are glad that we have these devices and we can have people that speak Spanish and they can know what is going on. And so this morning we are so happy to see you. We are glad to see you all here and we are going to worship Jesus. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, that we come, we join together, Lord, in unity to worship your name. Holy Spirit, move among us, Lord. We know that you are here. So, Lord, we ask you, Lord, that you feel the need of your people, that your church, Lord, that we come, Lord, to meet with you, and to praise your name, and to hear from your word. In Jesus' name, we put this service under your authority. Amen. God bless.
Before we worship this morning, I'm going to read a passage of scripture, which is an admonition or an urgency as Christians on how we are to live and walk. Just a few little tips. I'm going to be reading from Ephesians 5, 15 through 20, I believe. But after I wrote up the overhead there, I noticed the first verse prior to that, verse 14, says, "Wake up, sleeper! Rise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you." So I thought, oh, that was a good one to start with. And then it goes on to say, is everybody awake now? "Be very careful then how you live, not as unwise, but as wise, making the most of every opportunity, because the days are evil. Therefore, do not be foolish, but understand what the Lord's will is. Do not get drunk on wine, which leads to debauchery. Instead, be filled with the Spirit, speaking to one another with psalms, hymns, and songs from the Spirit. Sing and make music from your heart to the Lord, always giving thanks to God the Father for everything in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ." So let's do that this morning, and may these words from Scripture edify us and teach us. Let's sing some blessings to the Lord, and these songs will also bless our hearts as well. Let's stand together.
Bless the Lord, O my soul. Like never before, oh my soul, I'll worship your holy name.
Defender of the weak, you come Okay, in this next song, there's a part for the men, part for the women. We're going to, in the chorus part, we sing all together, but the first time we're going to sing this through, we're going to have the woman sing first, your part, and men, we're going to listen to their beautiful voices. All right, and then men, we're going to sing our part, and they're going to listen to our voices. Whether they're beautiful or not, they're going to listen to us. Sound good? But this first part, just repeat after me. The men will start, the woman, you repeat us. Let's sing this together.
You are holy.
You are holy.
You are mighty.
Let's hear the women.
You are Lord of lords, for King of kings. You are mighty God, Lord of everything. You're Emmanuel, you're the great I am. You're the Prince of peace, who is the man. You're the saving God, you're the saving grace. You will reign forever, you are ancient of days. You are Alpha.
Sing to and worship the King who is worthy. And I will love and adore Him. I will bow down before I will sing. I will sing to and worship the King who is worthy. And I will love and adore.
Try it all together.
You are holy.
You are holy.
You are mighty.
You are mighty.
You are worthy.
You are worthy.
Worthy of praise.
Worthy of praise.
I will follow.
I will follow.
I will listen.
I will listen.
I will love. I will sing to and worship the King who is worthy. I will love and adore Him. I will bow down before Him. And I will sing to and worship the King who is worthy. I will love.
Hola, Iglesia. I can't wake you up like Ruth did. But before I start, I just have to say something about my dear, dear artist friend, Joanna Arnett, who died last evening. She'd fought the fight. She walked the walk. She had cancer for the last 2 years, and she actually was my idol when it came to the Christian faith. She buoyed me up. She'd come into our Santa Fe church. She just glowed with the Spirit, and I know you probably know people like that. So I am doing the announcements, and a lot of you know me because I'm that little old lady that runs around taking photographs. And my name's Deborah Robinson. A lot of people know me by Debbie. And I love this church. The reason my husband and I originally came here was because I wanted a church. I have to admit he wanted the beach more, but and he wanted to be warmer. But I said, honey, you're going to have to put up because I want the beach. And the other thing that was exciting for me this week is my kid, one of them, finally came down to see me here because it was my 85th birthday. And I've always said, and I still will say, I feel like I'm 37. Well, years ago, I said to my husband, I said, why do I always say I'm 37? Now, I have to tell you, he wasn't quite with the Jesus thing for a long time. And he said, because you were born again when you were 37. So, anyway, I better get on with the announcements. You've already flipped a Cookie Sunday. I need to go back to the Benevolence Fund. Well, the Benevolence Fund was the first readout there, and it is Benevolence Fund this Sunday, and the Benevolence Box is in the back, and this is how we help our Mexican community. Okay, now you can do Cookie Sunday, second and fourth Sunday, and of course, if our dear beloved preacher was still here, he'd probably be munching on a cookie. And one thing I want to share about cookies. Since my husband died, I have to admit, I've hardly even turned on my gas stove anywhere, Santa Fe or here. But I love to bake, and I still make chocolate chip cookies in memory of him. I don't eat all of them. But down here, my stove does not want to cooperate, so I'm not making cookies. I go to Saturday Market, and just go to Saturday Market and give some of that wonderful money you have in your pocket to the lady who makes cookies. Okay. The pastor's desk. If some of you don't receive his letter, you really do need to sign on. His letter sometimes is very funny, but his letter also tells a lot about the community. And you know, the one thing I love about Chuck, because of his sharpening knives and doing all these things around the community, the people out in the town are getting to know the community church more and getting to know more about the Bibles, because his outreach in Saturday Market is really the Bibles that are out on his table. But what a wonderful outreach. So do sign up, because he tells just a lot of things on it. Oh, the YouTube channel. Because I was doing this morning and I have signed up, I decided to try an experiment. So I got on Google, and I have to tell you, after my husband's been gone for 5 years, Google has helped me learn how to program the garage opener and turn on my water sprinkler and all kinds of things. And you know, you guys are the reason why we keep you around. So anyway, I got on the YouTube channel. I Googled, I said, YouTube, and I said, San Carlos Community Church. Now, there were three things that came up, so I poked on the first one, and what did I get? I got Glenn doing a baptism in 2015, and I thought, that's not it. So I poked on the next one Google brought up, and it was the right one, and it says we have 88 subscribers. Now, come on, church, you know how to use the internet. If you older people do not know how to use your phone, use your computer, and sign up. Okay, grief share. Now I know quite a bit about this because our wonderful Christy, who practically runs our church, come on Christy, smile. Now, there are 13 videos, isn't that right? And I often wondered about that. That's kind of an unlucky number for grief share. Anyway, it's a wonderful, wonderful program. Any of you who have lost your husband, lost your daughter, your brother, your sister, whatever. Well, it's not whatever, but I can't tell you how much it helped me. Christy, actually the first person who started it was Marilyn Hicks. Some of you probably remember Marilyn. When I came to this church, I think she was already doing it. And then Christy took over, and Marilyn's now up in Tucson because they sold their place. But Christy herself, I believe, got interested because her beautiful, wonderful husband, Walt, she found on the floor of his shop probably 8 years ago. And, you know, that kind of shock, that kind of grief is, well, you know, with my husband, he decided he wanted to quit cancer treatment. So we were prepared. I mean, we talked over everything from our love to our finances to all how I would manage after he went. But for Christy to go take coffee out to his shop one morning and find him on the floor, you know, these kinds of grief are covered in these grief share videos, because the videos cover every kind of death you can imagine. Okay. Seminar and Bible study, it's been canceled until February 15th. This is on Thursday afternoons, and Chuck's been doing it. I've only made the one on feasts, and that was very interesting and very confusing. The Jewish people have so many feasts that seems to me they'd be feasting all year. Okay. Sidney Poitier in Lilies of the Field is our next movie. And you know, you guys, you get popcorn. He won an Academy Award for this movie. Did you tell me he's still alive or not? Anyway, this movie was made in 1963. That was the year I got married. Okay. Okay, Casper Esperanzas hosts the RMM medical team. Art and Brenda are in charge of that. I don't believe they have a sign-up table anymore, but they still could use volunteers for it. When is it? It's on. It's coming. Huh? Oh, you're here. Oh, stand up. Come on up. Let's give them a round of applause. Wonderful. Wonderful. I understand you go out to smaller villages around here, is that right? Yep. Okay. And then there's our wonderful translators, and I can say I don't recognize the one in the booth this morning. But anyway, what would we do without them? For one thing, it'd be a bunch of old whiteheads sitting around except for Denver and his family. But now we have all our wonderful Mexican community who bring in all their fabulous children, which Myra takes care of, and we have Sunday school. And don't we all love seeing those little children up here? And seems like we're producing more and more and more. Okay. U.S. mail drop. Is anybody going north? Okay. Gotcha. You know how to do it. You sign up that you're going to take the mail, and it depends, I don't know, on what day he's going. But just, huh? Oh, okay. Put your mail out there in the box, and Gail's husband, I totally lost it. I forgot your name. Dan. Okay. We'll take your mail. The gift of guests. Who's going to do this morning? Somebody going to run the gifts? Okay. Huh? I need you. I don't see him. No, his family's not here. Oh, okay. Thank you. Who is, we'll start over here. Who is a guest or new today is what I mean. Stand up, please. No? Nobody's new in this section? Oh, come on. You're shy. All right, this section, there are a lot of people new. So you want to stand up again? No? Okay, is there anybody else besides the Casa Esperanza people who are new over here? No. All right, how about here? Anybody new? Oh, that's right, I just met you this morning. From Silver City, New... Yeah, I should know, I live in New Mexico. Well, give us your name, I forgot it.
Jasper.
I forget names quickly. I think Tonda said he's a friend of your son's, is that right? Yeah, nice to have you. Okay, over here. Oh, over here. And where are you from?
Washington State.
That's okay. I know why you're down here, because it rains all the time up there. Okay. Nice to meet you. How about up here in the balcony? Anybody? Nobody new up there? Okay. Thank you. Adopt a newcomer. Well, I think you all know that we get a lot of newcomers coming in and out because they all want to come down here for the warmth. And I'm finding out on my pickleball court that the average of Canadians to Americans now is now 60 to 40. We're losing out. It used to be 40 to 60 American. I mean 60 to 40 Americans. Anyway, be welcoming to anybody like these people who are just visiting. And just reach out, take them to lunch or something. Okay, is that it? Thank you.
Good. Okay, a little bit more announcements. On the 22, we have the AGM, that's the annual general meeting, and we have a report of what we're doing during the year. The next is that we have a fundraiser for the youth retreat. If you want to contribute, we're going to have a little things. Not a lot. Some of the youth are sick, so they didn't come today, but if you want to support us for that retreat, you're welcome. Next. Yeah, okay. And there is different ways that you can contribute to St. Carlos Community Church. This church supports missionaries. So you can do it online, you can do it through here, and also by PayPal. And I ask for the ushers to come forward. We're gonna pray for the elder of the week, who is Betty Graham. She is so wise, and we are blessed to have her. Also, the missionaries of the week are Art and Brenda Kunis. They have the missionary center, and they host a lot of groups that comes during the year and also during the summer and winter. And they have a lot of working during all year. So we're going to pray, and we're going to ask the Lord to bless our offerings. Amen. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you are our provider, Lord. You are the one who gives us all the good things, Lord, and we want to give back for a little bit of all the blessing that you give us, Lord. You are so good. We pray, Lord, for Betty Graham, and we ask you, Lord, that you strengthen her and the work that she does for the church, Lord. Give her wisdom, Lord, and you guide her with your Holy Spirit. We ask you, Lord, for Brenda and Arcones, Lord, that you also, Lord, give them strength for all the work that they have ahead, Lord. Bless them with your wisdom, Lord, and give them the resources that they need for all the labor, Lord. Because they are doing a lot of things, Lord, for your glory, for your kingdom to be expanded, Lord. Bless them. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So you can go ahead. And I'm going to ask the kids to come. Where are the children? Thank God for all our kids. They are our children. We're going to pray for them today. We're going to bless them. Amen? Okay, let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for these beautiful children, for this generation, Lord, that you are raising. Lord, that they grow close to you, Lord, knowing you. And that they have, Lord, your love in their hearts, Lord, that they look to you. That they, Lord, are passionate about your word, Lord, and the relationship that they have with you, Jesus. We bless them in your name. Amen. Amen. God bless you.
Stand as we worship before Denver comes to share the word of God. You don't have to stand. If you would worship better sitting down, there's no real rules about it. But if you feel like you'd like to stand and stretch for a moment, join us for a couple more worship songs.
Crown aside, empty.
Lord, thank you for this day that you've given us. Thank you that we can gather here today as your children, gather as your church to worship your wonderful, holy, precious name. Thank you for the word that you've given us that is active, sharper than a two-edged sword, piercing the And thank you, Lord, that you're a living God, that you rose from the dead 3 days later. Thank you, Lord. I pray today that you may minister to our hearts, that we would hear your word, that you would convict our hearts, Lord, that you would encourage us,
And that at the end of today, Lord, our love for you may be strengthened. That you would, in return, be our greatest treasure. In your name we pray. Amen. Good morning, congregation. How are we doing today? Good. It's good to see so many amazing faces. My name is Denver Jantz, and I'm filling in for our dear pastor, Chuck, who left us early this week to be with his family, with Lynn as well, in Toronto, where his mother passed away. And so let's remember to keep them in prayers, that the Lord would meet them where they're at, minister to their hearts in this time of grief as well. Well, it is an honor and a privilege to be able to bring the word to you today. What greater joy is there to spend time in God's word and to hear from him what he has for us to hear? And I pray today that my words would not be spoken, but the words of the Spirit, that he would meet us where we're at today. We serve a living God who cares for us and where our hearts are at. And he desires for our hearts. Amen? There is a story of a young boy who loved boats. And he built this really amazing boat. He spent much time building it and crafting it, the sail and carving the wood. He poured his love into this boat. The day came where he wanted to test it to see if it would do what he built it to do. So he put it in the water, and the gust of wind picked its sail up, and down the river it went. This boat definitely worked, but that gust of wind took it further than the boy wanted it to. So desperately and frantically, the boy went into the water to try to regain the boat that he built. But the wind kept on taking it, and it went further and further downstream to the point in which the boy could not get the boat. And sadly, with a tear in his eye, he saw his beloved boat travel into the distance. So the boy goes home. His mother sees him entering into the door, the porch that way, with his head hanging. Son, did the boy not work? Did the boat not work? Yes, Mom, it worked. It worked too well. Days passed, and the boy was walking down the street of his town, and in a secondhand store window, something catches his eye. Ah! He runs into the shop, and he talks to the store owner and says, "That's my boat!" And the boy says, or the proprietor says, "No, it's not your boat, it's my boat." "No, you see, sir, it's my boat. I built that. Son, I'm sorry, but I bought this just the other day. But look, the marks of where I chiseled, and there's some scratches there. This is my boat." "Son, if you want the boat, you have to buy it." Well, the young boy had no money. He left the store, not disheartened, but determined. Determined to raise every penny he could to buy that boat back. So he worked hard. He slaved away. And once he had the right money, his first job, his first mission was to go back to that store and buy that boat back. There, he puts the money on the table to the proprietor and says, "One boat, please." So, with joy, the boy receives back the boat. As he's traveling down the road back home, he says, clutching the boat with his arms close to his chest, "I love you. You're my boat. You're twice my boat. You're my boat first because I made you, and you're my boat second because I bought you." This is a wonderful story of redemption. And redemption is a wonderful thing. Have you been twice bought, or have you been? Are you twice God's? We've all been created by God. And he did something amazing on the cross. He sent his son, Jesus Christ, to die for our sin, to pay for our sin, so that we may be bought back. So here we are. we have our story, our attention today is in Exodus chapter 2, verse 23 to chapter 3, verse 12. And I have three main observations that I want to share with you today. And the first being this. All people, I'll get back to that in a minute. All people are in need of redemption. All people are in need of redemption. Let's read the first passage here, starting at verse 23. During that long period, the king of Egypt died. The Israelites groaned in their slavery and cried out, and their cry for help because of their slavery went up to God. God heard their groaning, and he remembered his covenant with Abraham, with Isaac, and with Jacob. So God looked down on the Israelites and was concerned for them. The definition of redemption in relation to God and his story in the Bible is the action of saving or being saved from sin, error, or evil that can only happen through Jesus and the payment on the cross for our sin. It doesn't take much for us to see this state of our world. It doesn't take much for you to tune into the news, whatever news channel you may fancy you. And what do you hear? Not good news. That comes at the end with a one-minute clip. No, 99% of the news is bad news. We live in a sin-saturated world that's fallen, that is enslaved by the clutches of sin. We have experienced sin in our lives. Anyone here have ever had a cold before? I'm currently overcoming a cold, and my family is not here because they too have a cold. I've never met anyone who's been immune from a cold. You might think you exist, but you don't, because you're going to get sick this week if you think that. No, I'm just kidding. The truth is, though, no one is immune to the slavery of sin. Spiritual slavery is a very, very real thing. And if you've been born to this world, you've been born to the curse of sin. There are two responses to our spiritual slavery. There are two responses. Either there's ignorance toward it, believing there is no need to be rescued, or awareness of the sheer reality of its life-taking effect on you and being completely helpless in it. And all of us here today, at one point or the other, have either been there or currently are there. So let me speak to both of those things, okay? So, ignorance, believing there is no need for redemption. There are people out there who believe that I'm good. Goodness, I'm a law-abiding citizen. I pay my taxes. I'm a hard worker. I've never been late to work before. I don't speed. I have a good family. I go to church. I read my Bible. I even tithe. Have you ever met someone who is in complete denial, right? Like the people that think that they're not sick, don't have a cold? I'm all right. I'm actually reminded of a movie scene in one of the Monty Python films, if you're familiar. And there's a knight soldier, right? And he gets his arm, I think it was his arm or his leg, gets taken off. It's only a wound, flesh. I'm all right. Right? Or a flesh wound, rather. It's only a flesh wound. I'll be okay. And he keeps on his merry way and pretends like nothing has happened. He's lost a limb. Yes, you don't be in denial of your state. There are people who are in denial that they're in a spiritual slavery and that there is no need for redemption in their life. But if you're in this camp, for those who are in this camp, if you're true with yourself, is it enough? The life that you live, the life that you seek, is it enough? When it's all taken away, what will be left? If you're true with yourself, you are crying out just as the Israelites did. And then there are those who have awareness of their spiritual state. There are people in the world that are crying out just like the Israelites did because of the hurt and the pain that they experience day to day. Perhaps you are one of these people sitting here today. And no matter how hard you try, in your own strength, you cannot escape the bondage of the sin that is in your life. The sad reality is all mankind is born into bondage of sin and is destined to a Christless eternity. We need to get this. This needs to sink in for us. Hell is a very real place. And hell is created for the devil and his angels and all who reject the name of Christ. It says in Matthew chapter 25, verse 41, "Then he will say to those on his left, 'Depart from me, you cursed, into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels.'" The result of the fall of man, we know the story of the garden, of Adam and Eve, who disobeyed and who decided to follow their own hearts. What was the consequence of that? Death. There is a penalty for sin. There is a punishment for sin. And it's God's wrath against those who are opposing him, who are his enemies, for those who are sinners. There is not one who is exempt of this wrath. We need to recognize that we are in desperate need of saving. In order for redemption to be real for us, we need to recognize that we are in desperate need of Christ in our lives. And without him, there's only hopelessness, lack of joy, lack of peace. Presence of sin, the hurt in our heart, the pain, is still very real for us as believers too, right? There are many brothers and sisters here today that have gone and are going through immense pain in their life. And we too cry out, don't we? We too cry out to God. But something amazing happens. When we cry out, something amazing happens. And this is what leads us to our next point. When we cry out, God hears us. When you and I cry out, brother and sister, God hears us. Now, Moses was tending the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian, and he led the flock to the far side of the wilderness and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. There the angel of the Lord appeared to him in flames of fire from within the bush. Moses saw that though the bush was not on fire, it did not burn up. So Moses thought, I will go over there and see this strange sight. Why the bush does not burn up. When the Lord saw that he had gone over to look, God called him from within the bush, Moses, Moses. And Moses said, here I am. Do not come any closer, God said. Take off your sandals, for the place you are standing is holy ground. Then he said, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. At this, Moses hid his face because he was afraid to look at God. The Lord said, I have indeed seen the misery of my people in Egypt. I have what? I have heard them crying out because of their slave drivers, and I am concerned about their suffering. So I have come down to rescue them from the hand of the Egyptians and to bring them out of the land into a good and spacious place, land, a land flowing with milk and honey, the home of the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Amorites, the Perizzites, the Hivites, and the Jebusites. And now the cry of the Israelites has reached me, and I have seen the way the Egyptians are oppressing them. Did God hear the cry of the Israelites? Pretty evident in this passage that he did. And he was concerned for them. For those who are parents or have dealt with kids, you recognize the child's cry, right, as a parent? I've learned to understand my child's cry. There's times when they cry and I know it's, you know what, you're fine. That's one of those cries where you're just, it's more of an attention cry. And you can learn, you know when to pay attention or not, right? So those cries happen a lot. But then there's the cries that will wake you up in the middle of the night. It's that cry for help that cannot be misunderstood. And what is the natural response of a parent? Katie and I, well, Katie especially, it is dashing out of bed and going to the room, tripping over whatever is on the floor in your bedroom, to go to your child. You're concerned for them. You want to answer their cry for help. Isn't that amazing that we have that built into us as parents? It's amazing. And why is that? Well, it's because we've been created in the image of our Creator. He has given us a heart of compassion. He has given us a heart of a parent. Therefore, if the created can have such a response of love, how much therefore would the Creator have a response for his creation? God hears us when we cry out. Judges 3:9 says, when the sons of Israel cried to the Lord raised up a deliverer for the sons of Israel to deliver them. For Samuel 7:9, Samuel took a suckling lamb and offered it for a whole burnt offering to the Lord. And Samuel cried to the Lord for Israel, and the Lord answered him. Isaiah 65:24, before they call, I will answer while they are still speaking. I will hear. Before you cry out, God already knows what you're going to cry to him for. Jeremiah 33, verse 3. Call to me, and I will answer you, and show you great and mighty things which you do not know. Psalm 145, verse 18 to 19. The Lord is near to all who call upon him, to all who call upon him in truth. And in Luke chapter 5, verse 13, the leper fell to his face and begged Jesus and said, if you are willing, you can make me clean. What did Jesus do? He reached out and he touched the leper and he said, I am willing. You are clean. And the leper was healed. Brothers and sisters, God promises us in his word, and there are many more examples of this, that he will hear us when we call out in truth and humility. He will answer. He will answer your prayer in his perfect and sovereign will. And the greatest way that God can answer our cry to him is through his son, Jesus Christ. This is our last point. God has a plan of redemption for the world. God has a plan of redemption for the world. Many of us already know this, but I need the reminder, the daily reminder, that we have redemption, that I have a redeemer. The Bible is all about God's redemptive plan for the world. From Genesis to Revelation, we see the plan of redemption unfold. You can't miss it. Here in Exodus, it's plain as day. Jesus is not some character woven in once we get to Matthew. He is the main character, brothers and sisters. He is the main character from cover to cover. It's all about the Son. And he's the author of the story. For while we were still weak, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. God does something amazing for us. God the Father planned redemption before time began. And he sent his one and only Son to this world as the great example of that redemption, to save us from our sin. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to proclaim the good news, the gospel, to the poor. I'm poor. You're poor. He has sent me to proclaim liberty to the captives and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed. This is Jesus speaking in Luke chapter 4, verse 18. I was once blind. I was once oppressed. So were you, and perhaps you still are. God came to give sight to your hearts so that you may see the truth of who he is. He wants to set free your heart that is in captivity. Sounds like the Exodus, right? Yeah. So, how does... Here we are. All right. Let's read this first. So now go. I'm sending you to Pharaoh to bring my people, the Israelites, out of Egypt. But Moses said to God, who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt? And God said, I will be with you. And this will be the sign to you that it is I who have sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you will worship God on this mountain. How does Jesus redeem us from sin? There are four things that stuck out to me and in this passage, and the first is this. Jesus redeems us from sin through rescue. Jesus redeems us from our sin through rescue. Colossians 1:13. Which I don't have here. My apologies. Let me quickly find it here. I'm going to put my mic down. Bear with me. Sorry. It's 1:13. It says this. For he has rescued us from the dominion of darkness and brought us out into the kingdom of the Son he loves. In Exodus chapter 2 and 3, we read that God has a plan, a rescue mission for the Israelites, and he did it by sending Moses to free them from their slavery in Egypt. Moses obeyed and he went, and through God's power, he was able to release the Israelites from their captivity. God has provided for us deliverance from sin and death through his Son. Brothers and sisters, we have been rescued. When you were slaves to sin, it says in Romans chapter 6, verse 20-23, when you were slaves to sin, you were free from control of righteousness. What benefit did you reap at the time from the things you are now ashamed of? Those things result in death. But now that you have been set free from sin and have become slaves of God, the benefit you reap leads to holiness, and the result is eternal life. The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. We see we have redemption through ransom. Remember the definition given back at the beginning? Redemption is something in exchange for a payment. What was the payment in Exodus in chapter 12? The payment was the blood of a lamb, a spotless lamb, a pure lamb, one without defect. And what did God command his people to do with the blood? To put it over the doorpost so that the wrath of God may pass over them. This is the Passover celebration. They experienced ransom through the blood of the lamb. And what was the ransom paid, the payment paid at the cross? Blood of the Lamb of God. The precious blood of Christ. Only one who could spill his blood for us is one who is without sin, righteous, perfect, God himself. Ephesians 1:7 says, in him we have redemption through his blood, for the forgiveness of our trespasses according to the riches of his grace. Remember the garden when Adam and Eve sinned and they were found naked and they were ashamed? What did God do for them in his love and his grace? He slayed an animal and he covered their nakedness, their shame, with the skin. Blood was spilt in the garden to show atonement. We have life in the blood, and Christ's blood covers all transgressions and all iniquities. That's what the cross does for us. It atones. There is a great exchange that happens at the cross. Not only does God forgive us our sins, but God takes on our sin in bodily form and gives us his righteousness. This mic's going in and out like crazy. Can I change? Okay. Bear with me, people. Here we are. Okay, can you hear me? Very good, okay. He who knew no sin became our sin so that we might become the righteousness of God. He bore our sin in his body so that we may die to sin and live to righteousness. This is the work of the cross. Before the judge, guilty verdict, Christ comes and says, I will take that man's sin. I will take that woman's sin. And I will give them my righteousness. So when the verdict, God the Father, hammers and says, not guilty to you and I, but guilty to the Son. And when he sees his Son, he sees our sin. And when he sees us, he sees the Son's righteousness. This is the work of the blood of the Lamb. This is our identity. We do not move away from our justification. We move in it. It is our new life in him. Jesus redeems us through renewal. Jesus redeems us through renewal. Titus 3:5 says, he saved us not because of righteousness, not because of righteous things we have done, but because of his mercy. He saved us through the washing of rebirth and renewal by the Holy Spirit. Redemption is the action of regaining or gaining possession. The Israelites were freed from their slavery and had new life outside of Egypt. They had much to look forward to, the promised land that God promised their forefathers. They had new life, life in full, life that was had joy in it because they were freed from their slavery. We too have new life, renewed life in Christ, freed from sin and death, and we have new spirits or a new life in the Spirit, dead to sin and alive in the Spirit. And remember what happened after the Israelites left? As they were approaching the Red Sea, what happened? Well, Pharaoh crept up. He said, I'm not done. I'm going to go after these people. Even though he was defeated, he raised his head and he tried one last time to take them down. But God didn't allow it, and he closed the Red Sea on Pharaoh once and for all. We live in a world where sin is still very active. The power of sin is there. Yes, we're dead to sin, but the power of sin is still very real. But know this, brother and sister, in our renewed life in Christ today, we can have victory over that, just as the Israelites had a victory over Pharaoh. And there is a better day coming for us, where we will have renewed bodies, where there will be no more pain, no more suffering, no more death, no more sin, no more enemy, where we will be in the very presence of God, Jesus our Savior, in eternity. That is our hope that we can live in. We have everything we need in Christ. Jesus redeems us through relationship. God went to Moses. He went to him. It says that in Exodus chapter 2, verse 7. He went to him. Or he went to the people. But first he went to Moses by the burning bush and talked to him. And he was there with Moses in the miracles that he did for the Israelites and for Pharaoh in the land of Egypt. He was there guiding them by a pillar of fire at night and a cloud by day. He was there when he parted the seas, the Red Sea for them. He is there in the garden with Adam and Eve. He was there meeting Abraham as he drew water for him and had his wife make him a meal. He wrestled with Jacob. Remember that? He was there with Joshua, as Pastor Tuck mentioned last week. God is a God of relationship, and he desires for us to be in a relationship with him. And we can have one because he died for us, and we have new life in him, and the Spirit lives within us. And in our redeemed lives, we can have an intimate relationship with God. It says in the Gospel of John that the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things and bring to remembrance all that I have said to you. The disciples were wondering, you're going to heaven. Who will be here with us? Who's going to help us? He's sending the Spirit. Christ walked amongst man for years and showed us what it looks like to live a righteous life. He died for man on earth, and he lives in our hearts through the Holy Spirit. We have the opportunity to be in true communion with God through his Spirit. And the Spirit is in the business of sanctifying, setting apart us for the righteousness of his Son. Sanctification is not an add-on to salvation. It is the way God saves us, preserves us, brings us to glory. It is the continuing work of redemption in our hearts and minds through the new life we have in Jesus, as he, through the Spirit, ministers to our hearts and pulls us closer to him in a personal way. This is where true, rich, full joy can be found, in the presence of our Savior, our Lord and Savior, in true communion with Jesus, spending time with him, praying with him, resting in him, finding our refuge in him. This is what eternity will be all about. Embracing Jesus, being with Jesus, in full and perfect and complete relationship with him. And as we're reminded in Exodus, redemption can only happen through faith. The Israelites had to act in faith. God had a plan of redemption for Moses via him for the people of Israel, but they needed to act in faith. Faith means believing in something that is truth. Not wavering in something you think may be true, but being stock still in your belief and knowing that. Do we believe here today that Christ is our Redeemer? Do we believe in the power of the gospel, the power of the cross? Do we believe in the name of Jesus? Do we believe in his grace, the truth that he gives us? Christ is our Redeemer. Christ is our Savior. Christ is our ransom, our atonement. Christ is our righteousness, the high priest. Christ is the one and only everlasting God, the creator of all. Christ is the Son of God. Christ is Lord. Christ is our joy, our hope, our peace. Christ, our satisfaction and treasure. Brothers and sisters, we will be faced today and this week. Our faith will be challenged. We will face hardships in our life. And what the most vital thing for us is to remember the truth of the gospel, to remember that Christ is our Redeemer. We may rest in the gospel, its power every day. We must, we have to. We have no choice but to. If you want continuous victory in your life, the gospel must be compelling to your heart. I pray that Jesus may minister to our hearts this week as we continue on in what he's given us to do, and that we would find our ultimate joy and satisfaction in his name alone. Lord, we thank you for your work on the cross. We thank you that you loved us in such an amazing way that before time began, you had a plan of redemption for us. Thank you, God, that you sent your son, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, that you were willing, that you went to the cross with joy, knowing that through the cross, we could have life in you. Thank you for the gift of salvation. Thank you that you offer us this amazing salvation. Thank you that many of us have accepted that. And I pray for those who are still searching and wondering what to make of their lives. I pray that they would realize this, Lord. Open their hearts. That they would see the wondrous and glorious worth of the cross, that they would see the wondrous and glorious worth in you, Lord, our Redeemer. We thank you. In your wonderful name we pray. Amen. So now we'll take a moment to move into a time of communion. Fitting the message of redemption, the Lord's table, it's all about his work on the cross, the work of redemption, his paid blood, spilt blood for our payment, and that our Redeemer lives. Communion is a time in which we may remember what Christ did for us. That's why he gave it to us, this ordinance of the Lord's Supper that we can partake as Christ Church corporately. It's a time to reflect on his payment, on the blood spilt, his broken body, him taking on our sin, all of our sin, past, present, future, so that we may have a way to be reunited with the Father. But because he lives, this is a time of celebration. Just as God meant it to be for the Israelites, the celebration of the Passover, That's what it was. To celebrate their new life, the freedom of slavery into the life that he promised them. The passing over of God's wrath through the blood of the Lamb. We can rejoice in that we have redemption. We can rejoice that the blood of the Lamb covers our sin, and that in him we have new life for all those who believe in him. So let us now take a time, a reflection on God's work upon the cross.